Learning about basic cross-site scripting is very simple, and I don't want to explain XSS again in this video. I'll link some stuff here. But the question I try to answer today is how to get good with XSS, because I do think you can take XSS to quite a crazy level. A lot of people hear and dream about becoming a bug bounty hunter, making thousands of dollars, sitting at home looking for vulnerabilities. It seems so cool. And XSS issues are super typical bugs for bug bounty programs, and also fairly easy to look for. So it's no surprise that you see a lot of people sharing XSS cheat sheets or XSS vector collections. And if you have such a list, then all you have to do is copy and paste line by line the vectors into some input field and hope you see the magical alert box pop up. Now you are a cool hacker and you can tell all your friends you earned money with hacking. And maybe you even go so far to write your own scripts and tools to try out all these vectors automatically, or maybe you just reuse somebody else's script, because in the end, why should you be a glorified copy and paste machine? Well, maybe I sounded a bit condescending to you if you are kinda at this level, so let me clarify, I started the same way, everybody did. And I also think creating a tool to automate looking for XSS vulnerabilities is great. I think trying to solve this problem of programming a good XSS scanner and really thinking about it is a fun challenge. You probably face interesting edge cases and issues that you will learn a lot from. So I don't want to discourage anybody from doing that, but please don't try to sell that as a product. Either way, you will probably find issues in bug bounty programs with this method. So what's the problem? Well, I hope you agree that this is really just the first chapter. If I would try to draw a timeline of how much time you should spend in each chapter of getting good at XSS, then this is just a small sliver of it. I'm not judging anybody who just started and is passing through that early part. Keep going, you have an awesome ride ahead. And hopefully this video plays a role in it. But I maybe judge you if you 2 years later still copy and paste vectors. This is what I meant with this tweet here a while ago. Move away from basics as quickly as possible and constantly expose yourself to stuff you don't understand. So let's have a look at these two XSS vectors which were shared on Twitter. If you have a little bit of XSS experience, on first sight they might look similar. You probably can notice some HTML tag, and probably there is a string JavaScript here, and both are supposed to show some kind of JavaScript execution. They are XSS vectors, right? Now, the first tweet here offers a little explanation. Apparently, we have an output tag in HTML5 along with the name attribute now, and somehow this is something new for XSS. So apparently there is something special about the output tag. And when we look at the proof of concept, it looks crazy. Lower and uppercase letters, a weird newline HTML entity, a weird Unicode escape sequence, another HTML entity, and all of that is the name attribute. And then we have an onClick handler which executes the JavaScript eval name. Okay, before I go further into what is happening here, let's look at the other tweet. So here we have three HTML tags. A base tag and two anchor tags. The base tag has an href with JavaScript and some arbitrary looking /a/-alert1/... what? And then one anchor tag has an href with a relative path going one layer up with ../ and lol safari.html, and the other is just an empty anchor tag. Okay, Now let's test them out. In the end, you want to see the action, right? So here's a very simple PHP script. I created a form with a text area called XSS where we can submit the input, and down here we have a div where we will just echo whatever we have submitted. Oh, and I also set the HTTP header here to disable the browser's XSS auditor. We don't want that to interfere. Then I start a local PHP test server with PHP -S and port 1337, and then we can take Chrome and open that page. Now we can enter something here, press the submit button, and we can see the echo result. Hello world. Let me also show you the relevant HTML source for the output. We can also now see what happens when we submit HTML tags. Now it's bold hello world. Cool, so we can easily inject HTML and observe the result. So let's copy in the first tweet and submit. And here's the X. We know it has the onClick handler, which means we have to click, and yep, we get an alert 1. So this executed JavaScript on a click. Now let's copy the other tweet. Submit, and we see both anchors, both links, test and haha, but when we click on them, it doesn't work. The one link even redirects to lolsafari.html. I guess it was making a reference here that it only works with Safari. So let me open the page in Safari and try to click now here. And yes, we get the alert. So I want you to look at both of them again. What is it you take away from them? There are a few different angles here. First of all, one has a lot more retweets and likes than the other one. This could be an indication that people found this one a lot more interesting, insightful, crazy, or just more useful. And based on our tests, we could also make a case for it actually being more useful, right? I mean, the first one appeared to just simply work, while the second one just worked in Safari. That seems a lot less useful. Now, the first one also seems to make use of a lot more crazy things. Like, there's alternating low and uppercase characters, there are two different kinds of HTML entities, there's a Unicode escape, and apparently something new or special about the output tag. That is an indication that some crazy stuff is happening there. It looks really complex. While the other tweet just has some more basic JavaScript colon, though then it also has some weird slash a slash minus and then the alert, but it seems a lot more simple, right? Well, okay, so please excuse my rage that will follow now. I know this anger might seem unnecessary, maybe I'm just taking it way too seriously, maybe this is such a small thing that I should just ignore it, or at least not make a video about it, but I think here's actually something very interesting that I want to share, something that is very important to me, that people understand this, and I think it helps people to move on from basics and get a much deeper understanding of the possible craziness that can come with XSS. Well, the first tweet here is pretty much useless garbage. Well, okay, that's maybe unfair, everybody, even I, can extract some useful thing out of it, but for the sake of the story, for the point I want to make in this video, this is crap, okay? But let me explain why. Reason number one, it is misleading and deceptive. The author of this XSS vector tries to make this look more crazy than it actually is. Let me create a clean version of this. The capitalization of this is just distraction. Actually, the whole JavaScript colon is just distraction. The Unicode escape sequence, just distraction. The one HTML entity, just distraction. Actually, the whole name attribute thing and eval here is bullshit, just distraction. You could also just write onClick alert 1. XSS cross-site scripting is about JavaScript execution. We use alert 1 with the pop-up because it's a very visual proof that you achieved JavaScript execution. So the XSS vector, the thing that triggered JavaScript execution here, is the onClick event handler, a very basic, typical beginner-level XSS vector. I said that the name attribute with the eval is bullshit because it has absolutely no value for XSS. All that it is doing is it places the JavaScript payload, the alert 1, into the name attribute of an output tag, and inside of the event handler, you can access the name as a variable like this. This is just like how the output tag works. But like I said, I think it's just distraction. It's just putting the alert somewhere else, but it's irrelevant because it is executed because you already execute the eval. So basically, this minimal example is what it boils down to. And the second reason why I think it's garbage is this description. We now have an output tag in HTML5 along with name attribute. Makes it sound like something crazy, new or special. But the description along all these other distractions just add to the cloud of confusion to hide that this is bullshit. And don't get at me with it executes alert 1, this could bypass some filters, the output name attribute is in no XSS vector list, I don't care. I can't help but think this is all just trying to make it more than it actually is. I hope I made it clear why I think it's just deceptive and offers zero value for your education of learning XSS. Studying that example will get you nowhere. That being said, I don't necessarily want to attribute malice if the person just genuinely has no clue. If you wrap something into a confusing cloud of partially true content, you can get quite far in any industry. Anyway, let's go to the second tweet. At this point, you can probably guess that this must be something crazy and much more interesting. So to understand this, we have to know two things. A typical XSS vector that you can find in any copy and paste XSS vector list is an anchor tag with a JavaScript URI, something like this. If you click that, you execute the JavaScript. The second thing we need to understand here is what the base tag does. The HTML base element specifies the base URL to use for all relative URLs contained within a document. There can only be one base element in a document. And we can see here two relative URLs. Simply speaking, if you define a base tag like example.com and you have a relative URL, you get a full example.com URL. You see here we are on localhost right now, but the base tag basically turns every relative URL into an absolute URL using that specified base, and so we go to example.com. You can also use the JavaScript console to inspect the href of these anchor elements and see the full URL. Now, if you are smart, smarter than me because I never thought about that, you might ask yourself, could you define a base tag with the JavaScript URI and every relative link on a website would be prefixed with JavaScript colon? Imagine you just inject one single base tag and every link on the site turns into a XSS. Well, that would be kind of stupid. It doesn't make sense to have that as a base URL, and this doesn't work in any browser. In this case, the base is basically ignored and the link remains relative. That's good. Thanks, browsers, for being sane here. We know the tweet worked in Safari, but this simple example doesn't even work here. With the console, you see that the base tag seems to be ignored. So what's different in the tweet? Let's try this again. JavaScript colon slash a slash minus alert one. If we check now the console, we see that it actually prepended the JavaScript. And when we click now, the alert one is executed. So why does this happen? Let's move back to Chrome for a moment. Let's try to come up with a fictional scheme, ASD colon slash slash liveoverflow.com. If we do that as a base, that actually works. Now we have an ASD URL. But if we try JavaScript, we actually see an error. JavaScript URLs might not be used as a base URLs for document. However, if you try that in Safari, nobody complains. It seems to work. You can even see that in the console. Though if we try to put there an alert now, like this, and click, nothing happens. But look at the URL. We run into an annoying issue. So if this is a JavaScript URI, then all of this is just interpreted as JavaScript code. I give you a hint. Here, ding ding. Remember what two slashes in JavaScript or some other programming languages mean? Slash slash is a comment. So basically all the JavaScript payload afterwards is just a comment. It's just an empty script now. Of course you might think, well, then let's remove the slash slash and just have a clean JavaScript URI, but then also Safari refuses that. Now the base tag is simply ignored. So we need it to look like a normal URL with colon slash slash. Or maybe colon slash? For whatever crazy reason, the author of this tweet figured out that Safari can be tricked into thinking this is a URL with only one slash. And then you can use a regex. In JavaScript, you can define a regex with slash and then the regex and then slash. So in here, you could put any regex stuff. Totally fine. And then you subtract alert one from that regex. And now the JavaScript has to be executed. That subtraction obviously makes no sense, but first you have to evaluate alert one to take the result and subtract it from the regex. So this means alert one is executed. Boom, XSS. Playing around with this myself, I actually also realized you can, instead of the regex subtraction, use an empty multiline comment. So slash star and then close it immediately with star slash. So now the alert one is a bit cleaner. Small pro tip, we can add a small thing to cause a JavaScript error. Then when we get this error in the console and click here to look at the script with the error, then we can see how the browser interprets this JavaScript. And here you can see the comment. And actually, the slashes at the end are also there for a reason. So the full URL of a link is built by combining the base with the anchor href. And so if you go a directory up with ../, you can simply add a few slashes or a few folders at the end of the base, so this ../ will consume one of these slashes. Now the author just added a bunch of them in case you had more relative links with even more ../... This is just to be sure the XSS works in most cases. This is absolutely insane, right? This really shows a deep understanding of the web, browsers, and XSS, exploiting a weird quirk in Safari. Look, if you are interested in the alert one and you just want bounties, well then maybe you don't care. I mean, how often really does an injection into a base href come up, or how often can you not inject anything besides a base tag? And then it only affects Safari, right? Your time is probably then spent better copy and pasting a few more XSS vectors into input fields. But I truly believe being able to figure this out, being able to understand why it works, and being able to appreciate this as a piece of valuable research, this will differentiate you from the beginners that work through simple lists. You should recognize this as the goal where you want to get to if you are interested in XSS. This is where, for me, real hacking starts. This is what I think deserves to be called art. It's so damn creative. And now let's compare these tweets again. While they both look crazy on first sight, this one was using weird entities and Unicode escapes and unnecessary capitalization to deceive from how simple and basic it is. While this example has weirdness and craziness with /a/-alert1/, for very good reason, and it all matters for this XSS. If I would be the head of a university, I would love to award this author for this amazing research a PhD in XSS. Thumbs up if you agree. And because I think it's so sad that this amazing tweet only got so little likes and retweets compared to this one, I would like to reveal who it is. This is Gareth Hayes. He is an incredible client-side browser security researcher who has done amazing work for many years. He deserves every like and retweet.